The Family Responsibility Office's role is to facilitate court-ordered child and spousal support payments in the province of Ontario. It also happens to be the most complained about provincial government organization. So joining us now to detail what her ministry is doing to change the course of the FRO, here's Helena Jaczek. She is the Minister of Community and Social Services and the MPP for Oak Ridges Markham. And we, of course, welcome you to be part of this conversation. Share your thoughts on tonight's topic using the hashtag AgendaTVO. Minister, good to have you at TVO. Thanks for coming in.
Very good to be here, Steve.
Well, if you are not, I guess, directly affected by this office, meaning you owe money or somebody you are owed money, you may not have heard of the FRO. So let's start simple here. How many people, how big a job are we talking about in Ontario in terms of how many people this affects?
The Family Responsibility Office has 180,000 cases on its books right now, and that affects some 380,000 people when you take into account the payor, the payee, dependent children. So it
is
a lot.
Is that number getting bigger or smaller?
It's actually maintaining fairly a stable rate. We don't close cases in Ontario, so many remain open. And we're seeing basically a fairly consistent rate of new entries.
I have heard it said that the Family Responsibility Office is more a reactive rather than proactive agency, just, I guess, by nature of its mandate.
That's precisely it.
Have you been able to change that over the years at all?
There have been a lot of efforts. I'm sure you appreciate, as an MPP, when I opened my first constituency office in 2007, we started getting complaints in my constituency office. And there was a major review and a number of improvements made through the years. I have noticed a change as an MPP following about 2011. There were a number of measures that seemed to be making a difference so that we were getting fewer complaints in our office. Obviously now I'm the minister responsible for the last 5 months, and I can tell you, Steve, the first visit I made to one of our offices of the Ministry of Community and Social Services was to FRO up in Downsview.
Let me, before you took over, and actually before you started to get those complaints, let me read something that I know you've probably seen before from the Ombudsman's reports. These are going back 4 years now, the first one. FRO, it says, has been among our office's top three complained about organizations for the past 5 years. And the percentage of complaints about FRO relative to the total annual complaints has increased from 7.3% to 9.5%. We continue to see cases where FRO takes no action for months or even years until prompted by Ombudsman staff. Now that's from the 09-10 report. Let's continue. This one's just from this year. The Family Responsibility Office is consistently a top source of complaints to the Ombudsman. In 2013-14, complaints were up significantly to 1,157 complaints, 46% higher than the 794 received in 2012-13. Now these are only, you know, official complaints. I imagine a lot of people are too frustrated with the office and have either given up or don't bother complaining. But even based on that math, that's three complaints every day to the Ombudsman's office. What sort of problems are people having there?
Well, I think you've touched on one issue that, first of all, we need to put things a little bit in perspective. The numbers are vast. There are something like 8,000 calls to the FRO office every day. And as we've said, 180,000 open cases. You're dealing with people who, quite understandably, are facing a very emotional situation in their lives. They've separated, they've had to go to court, they receive a court order, and quite honestly, what we find is only one-third of payors actually pay the full amount on a monthly basis.
Can I infer from this it's probably 99% of the time men who are in arrears here?
It's not exclusively males at
but
all.
That's a nice way of saying it's overwhelmingly males.
It is mostly males.
Yeah, okay.
It is.
So men aren't paying.
Some men are not paying. There are a number of cases outside of FRO. There is an opportunity where the couple is in full agreement and they are outside the system and they just make their own private arrangements. But of those who end up with a court order, we do see one-third willing to pay, one-third paying partially, and one-third who make every effort not to pay.
And do I presume they are the top priority, that one-third who just has no interest in paying?
Absolutely. And, you know, as I mentioned, I went up to the office. I was really interested. I sat beside caseworkers, and they're almost like Sherlock Holmes. I was so impressed with their determination to try and find the individual who is supposed to pay. People give wrong phone numbers. They give wrong addresses or a family member's address. They give the wrong name of their employer. It's absolutely frustrating to see to what extent people try and avoid paying. Of course, they also move to other jurisdictions, other provinces, other countries. I was really impressed in terms of our frontline people who are doing everything they possibly can. I mean, we have an imperative for us that we want to find the payor, because obviously we want to avoid people going on social assistance, and if they have no other source of income, that's what's going to happen. So the government has a real incentive to try and find the payors.
Well, we actually have a bit of a behind-the-scenes look here at what goes on. I know on your website you've got some behind-the-scenes videos. So let's show a snippet of this behind the scenes at FRO. Roll tape, please.
Compliance rate is close to 70%. So around 30% of the cases are the ones that really need enforcement. And that's when we would put in place a garnishment with the federal government. And in this case, what we would attempt to capture is income from the federal government, like EI payments, income tax refunds, putting in place a writ of seizure where we attach property that is under the person's name. The person goes to sell a property, for example, and they find that we have a writ in place, and we'll tell them, well, unless everything is paid, brought up to date, we won't be able to withdraw it. And in most cases, we get the payments like that.
Okay, but having said that, if somebody, for example, moves from Ontario to another province in the country, are they beyond your reach?
No, we do have some connections with other provinces where we can request information from their database, driver's licenses, for example, because one of the best enforcement mechanisms, as I heard from the caseworkers, was suspension of a driver's license. That leads to rapid compliance. But we would like to do a lot more. I just recently wrote a letter to the federal government, because there are a couple of databases that they have that we would like to have access to. There are records of hire that are kept by the federal government. It's rather more to see if someone has employment insurance eligibility. Of course, as soon as they get a new job, they should be off EI. So there is information that the federal government has, and I've just written to Ministers Kenny and McKay to ask for Ontario to also have access to that.
It does make you wonder, though, there's no limit to the kind of creative avoidance people can employ if they want to avoid having to pay whatever they're supposed to pay. And your office, with all due respect to the people who work there, probably can't be that creative in tracking them down. So
they do the very best they can. You know, we are in court. It's something like 8,000 court appearances a year by our legal staff to use enforcement mechanisms at our disposal, things like passport suspensions, some of the ones that were mentioned in your video. There is a limit to someone who is absolutely determined not to pay. There's no question.
There's 2 billion plus outstanding right now, right? $2.1 billion in arrears.
And 12.1 billion collected.
And 12.1 billion collected, you hasten to add. Okay. But having said that, what do you think can be done to get that number under better control? That's an enormous amount of money that should be in somebody else's pocket as opposed to the pocket of the person not paying.
In Ontario, we have kept the arrears on the books since the beginning of government's intervention in what was previously seen as a private matter between two parties. So the numbers of arrears, the dollar figure, the 2.1 billion, that goes back to 1987. We don't write them off our books because we feel it's still a debt. However, our collection rate does, I think, justify what we're trying to do. We get a dollar collected for every 8 cents that we pay on FRO. So overall, we're doing a good job, as good as we can. If people, we're always open to suggestions. One of the issues is timeliness, and I think you mentioned that. What we have observed, of course, is that the court system is paper-based, and the time it takes for the court order to reach our office, in fact, when I was sitting with the caseworker, there was an example, it was some 4 months before the court order actually arrived. Hmm. So obviously I am having conversations with the Minister of the Attorney General, Madeleine Meyer, who is a former Minister of Community and Social Services, to see what we can do in terms of getting that court order either in the hands of the payor payee immediately or some electronic transfer as opposed to a paper-based system.
I hear you, and I get that you've only had the job for 5 months. I remember covering stories at Queen's Park about this 25 years ago. I mean, this is not a new problem. Do you have to look at some kind of revolutionary new way of doing business? I don't know, maybe farming the whole thing out to the private sector? I don't know what.
It was a question I asked during one of my early briefings. What about collection agencies? And it was very interesting because Dwight Duncan, as Minister of Finance a number of years ago, had made a suggestion along those lines. And a small pilot project was, in fact, conducted by FRO, and the collection rate was actually worse than our own caseworkers.
So that wasn't any better.
It was not, and I believe one other province may have tried it as well. So the majority of jurisdictions, even globally, it is a government function to assist parties in the midst of a custody battle.
If you look at the numbers, Ontario compared to the rest of the country, it appears that Ontario is a little more than a quarter of the total staffing to try to get that money, but the province is closing in on two-thirds of the national monetary backlog. Does that suggest that staff is just like hopelessly outnumbered when it comes to the job required?
I don't get that feeling at all. I have challenged my officials in the ministry. I would, if there's a feeling that the caseload is too heavy, I would like to know that. There have been a number of mechanisms to streamline the workload. So a new computer system, there is a lot of work now being done in terms of mail outs, requesting checks and so on, that is now done by the Ministry, I think it's of Government Services. So our caseworkers are given much more time to do the detective work to try and find the payor.
I note, though, that Manitoba has a proportionately smaller staff but seems to get more money as a proportion of the national picture brought in. Are they doing something we're not?
Actually, you have to be very careful that you're comparing apples to apples. Some of the other provinces actually write off the arrears, even in the case of Quebec, within 2 years. As I mentioned before, ours are on the books since 1987. The better comparators to Ontario are British Columbia and Alberta. And if you happen to have those numbers,
I have them right here.
I think you'll see that Ontario fares pretty well in terms of the arrears per case.
They're very comparable.
They're pretty comparable. Yeah. And we measure things the same way.
Gotcha. So what improvements are you putting in place?
Well, we continue to try and find creative ways to deal with timeliness in particular. I did mention this issue of trying to get the court order in a timely fashion. We have now the ability to turn around the court order within 30 days, which is our business practice. That's the upper limit. Most of our documents are turned around within 48 hours. So we've made a whole lot of mechanical, technical changes to the process.
Website? Self-serve website?
We're going online with what's called FRO Online in 2015, where people can make adjustments to court orders online. And we feel this is a significant advantage rather than having to go back to court, which of course has its attendant legal fees and so on. That's an improvement as well. But We also, I think, something that is more of a quality issue, and but it's important for those payees who are waiting. Every client now has an assigned caseworker, so they don't have to sort of repeat the whole story over and over through a call center. And that's a fairly recent change. That was the change that was made in 2011. So you're dealing with the same person. And that seems to be, as I say, a quality issue, but also it's a time issue as well for people.
This issue came up at one of the committees of the legislature earlier this month that was studying it. The Welland MPP, Cindy Forster, raised the issue of a fee that users will be charged to access the new self-serve website. And she said, it doesn't really seem right that people would have to pay a fee to actually go online and perhaps reduce the work of that ministry. They should actually be rewarded instead of penalized by having to pay a fee to log on to get what is ordered by the courts to help them support their kids. Is she right?
I think we have to go back to what government is trying to do here. There's a dispute between two individuals. There's a court order. Usually legal counsel is involved in that whole process. FRO Online essentially is going to allow people to avoid a legal fee. We haven't set the fee. I think if you read the transcript in Hansard, you will note that my deputy minister made it very clear that it's still under consideration. So we haven't landed on what that would look like. What I would assume it will be simply our costs to be recouped for the processing, but it would not be anything like a legal fee that would be required to go back to court.
How about accessing the health card database as a means of helping to trace and locate people?
Yes.
Is that an option?
It is, and I believe that that is actively being used. There's actually quite a move amongst many of the ministries, because we do talk to each other, because we obviously overlap. The issue of a unique identifier, you know, we have so many different numbers, so all sorts of things are being looked at to try and make it easier to track people, in essence.
Let me, in just our last minute here, I want to ask you one more thing. You're the Minister of Community and Social Services, which is a vast, huge bureaucracy of different social service issues and problems. I mean, this is one of them, but there are dozens of them. Given that this problem has been a problem for, you know, going on a quarter of a century right now, I am curious as to how high a priority you put on this particular problem versus the other ones you've got to deal with, in hopes of getting some progress on this.
I am going to push as hard as I can. There's no question that it is a priority. As I said before, it impacts on how many people end up on social assistance. For us, it is a vital component of the many different programs.
How will you know if you're making any progress?
I think what we will see is the complaints dropping off. I don't think we'll get too many thank yous, because unfortunately people are under a great deal of emotional distress in these situations. But I think you started off with your ombudsman's reports and so on. So what I hope is that we see significantly fewer complaints.
Fewer complaints. Gotcha. Dr. Helena Jaczek, Minister of Community and Social Services, good of you to come into TVO tonight. Thanks for your time.
Thank you.
Support Ontario's public television. Donate at tvo.org.